Roscom, Conversations and Coffee. I'm Ellen O'Shaughnessy, coordinator of this program that's been going on for a few years, since 1982 or 3, when it was started with Phyllis Green, continued with Susie Hanna, and then myself. A wonderful way that we share the stories and the creativity of the artists we invite to be a part of our lives here at the Cultural Arts Center. So welcome, delighted to have you. We are so happy to have someone among us who understands how the text, the written word, can get kind of lost. Have you ever been reading a book and you think, oh, I'm so tired here in a book club, I don't know if I can read the next 400 pages. Eileen Woods knows how to transition from the text to the beauty of artistic visual expression. And she's going to share that with us today. How she takes what is what the death of a word
death
to
of
new
human.
Yes, the death of the human and the word, and that word among us in this amazing expression of art. So Eileen went got her Master of Fine Arts at Ohio State University and painted for some time. We had Eileen for Conversations and Coffee in 2002, and as painting was a part of Eileen's life, she one day put the paints down and said,
I'm done.
I'm done. And that happened because, Eileen, tell us.
I was painting portraits primarily. I had a commission with McGraw-Hill to do, I think it was about 115 portraits of the most famous educators through history. I mean, all the way from Socrates to today. It wore me out. It was just, I wasn't happy at the end of it. I wasn't happy with the direction. I wasn't happy with how I couldn't say anything of how I felt. This was strictly commission work. And paint, I wasn't appreciating paint anymore. I was jealous of people who loved to paint because they love paint. They love the manipulation, the chemistry. That was never the case with me, even though I got a degree in it. So when I finished that last portrait, I knew I was done. And I set down the brush. I said, I've got to find a new way. And so for years, I went in all kind of different directions. I used mirrors, I used rust, I used glass. And finally, one day, I started to experiment with fabric, with collage, and I sort of found a good way to say what I wanted to say that wasn't using paint, that wasn't using the traditional methods anymore.
So here we are with an exquisite tent. That is beautiful. And you're asking us to get inside and read the text and be surrounded by the fabric.
The fabric is, I picture that as an inside-out garment, in a way. Mm. Ugly, you can see McDonald's emblems, zippers. If you look closely, it's each piece is a different, from a different garment. And I think it's ugly from the outside. My hope was that when you went in, it would be a different experience, that you would get start to get a sense of the universe really, stars, eternity. And so that was the goal, and I hope that when you do go in, if you haven't gone in, I hope you do, and just take a moment, reflect, and let it surround you. You can start to read the text after a while. Each piece, what you can't see very well, is each piece is first burned. The text is burnt into it. I wasn't happy because you couldn't really read it enough, so I went back and poked holes with the same tool to make sure that you could read the text. So it's actually burnt twice. It's insane, and this took a year.
How did you burn it?
Glad you asked. This is it. This is my tool. It's just a wood burning tool, and I just burn fabric, burn text into fabric. Every piece of fabric takes burning differently. In fact, I brought little samples here to get interested later to see how that works. Sometimes holes are burnt into the fabric, sometimes nothing happens. So through years of experimentation, I was able to finally find the match, the perfect match.
I think the tent is beautiful.
Well, thank you. Yes.
Does the burning have a meaning for you in the work?
It started off just, I noticed that people, to incorporate text into work, you either write it down or you embroider it. But I wanted to find a way that I'd never seen before. And I was doubly happy when I realized that also, because I was incorporating last words of people, that the holes, the scorching, all of that seemed to fit the whole concept. That's how that happened.
It's neat.
Thanks.
I'm sorry. It's wonderful, the piece behind you.
This is called Utter Nonsense, and those were the last two words spoken by Eleanor Roosevelt, apparently. She said the words in response to, I believe, her housekeeper knew that she was on her way out. And she basically said, no one dies until they've got it right with God, in so many words. That's what Eleanor Roosevelt said, utter nonsense. That was it. This work is by George Sanders, his last words. And I can read it to you. Dear world, I am leaving you because I'm bored. I feel I have lived long enough. I am leaving you with your worries in the sweet cesspool. Good luck. And he wrote this in a suicide note. Suicide notes, to me, you know, how wonderful that, in a way, sick, twisted way, that you can plan your last words. We're not going to get that chance. So I contemplate that, and I think, well, you know, if I had a chance, and I'm sure, you know, this is something you may think about when you see this show, I don't know. If I had the chance, what would I say? And that idea carried me through to this piece. This is by Diana Athill, who is still alive, I think. It's the only one I did that is of a person that's still alive. And I think she just hit 100. But she said, it's all right, don't mind not knowing. She said, that's what I hope I say. Well, I appreciate that. I appreciate thinking ahead. Well, maybe that can also be a way of living, is knowing what you'd like to say and saying now, whatever it is. Do you want me to talk about another piece? These are the last words of Bobby Fischer. There's a little dispute about exactly what he said. There may be two or three words that are a little different, but the concept is the same. Nothing is as healing as the human touch. Bobby Fischer, for those of you who are familiar with the name, he was a chess champion. And he was notorious for being cold, not wanting people to touch him at all. So how ironic that that is what he said.
And what did, you want to repeat that he said that after you said that? What did he say?
He said nothing is as healing as the human touch.
Amazing.
Oftentimes I've done, I have probably 50 pieces in this series. And oftentimes I've used the last words of hospice patients because to me they're beautiful, they're mysterious, they had no idea that these words would survive them. But I like the fact that they are anonymous, but yet so impactful. Any other? Yes, Alice.
I was wondering the shapes of materials. I was wondering, is it the words that
talk into that?
I was wondering. Is it the words that inspire the shape of the pieces, or is the person that said the words that has more impact on the shape of pieces?
Both, all of that. Sometimes I will run into a phrase that just moves me enough to look for the fabric to match the words. Sometimes the person will dictate the kind of fabric I get. So I play both ways. Here's Tammy Faye Baker, and I knew that she was dying a long time. I looked for a sort of a nightgown to go with her words. I'm in the hands of Jesus. I also thought, well, Tammy Faye is known for mascara makeup, so I put mascara on these red hands and incorporated all of the emblems of Christianity. But, you know, I could go either way. The words were fabric.
Yes.
I picked up a book, picked up a book at a garage sale this summer. It's called Epiphanies.
It's called what?
Epiphanies. And it's all things from gravestones and, you know, but a lot of them were pre-written.
Yes.
People had prescribed them, and some of them are famous people and some are not, like you're saying. And it's so interesting what people think is important for them to say.
Right. Yeah, Spike Mulligan, he asked it on his tombstone to say, "Hey, Galen, I told you I was sick." Any other questions? This piece is sort of an outlier. And I cannot read it because it's in Portuguese. But basically it says, "I take the first step in the path of eternity, and I leave life to enter history." And this is in a suicide note written by Vargas, a Brazilian president. So I thought about, in answer to you, Alice, I thought about eternity. I decided to make the kind of wheel that I could just keep adding to if I wanted to. Right now, it's probably 200 or 300 yards of fabric. But that gives me a sense of eternity. And the circle, of course, is a sign of eternity. And that brought to mind this piece by Eric Last was Barry Garner, who, you know, we all recall in 2014 with horror when he said, "I can't breathe," before he died. The circle again, but also how the circle created a target to me, which, of course, in a political sense, we can identify with. So that's the only piece in this show that has rust, which is in the title of our show. I do use rust a lot, but only survive with the show.
As you say, you use the materials. What's it like to work with those materials?
It depends on the materials. Some fight with me and some don't. That sucker there fought with me for a year. But some burn easily. It's funny because I thought I couldn't write anymore. You know, with computers, we've all lost the ability to handwrite. But this show, I had to, and so I can write again, over and over and over and over. Yes?
On this garment, did you actually write that many times?
Yes. I know, Mamma Mia, right?
Yeah,
I did. That repetitive method.
The lines are so straight, did you have them on something?
Don't look closely. Sometimes I listen to radio while I'm doing it, and whatever song is playing ends up in the garment. You know, don't look closely because you'll see this spell. Yeah, I get distracted sometimes, but I like the fact of repeating and repeating and repeating the phrase. First of all, it puts me in kind of a mantra. It reminds me of a mantra. But also, I like the fact that because they're so hard to read sometimes, and especially when they're in different languages, if you can't read it up here, somewhere on that garment, you're going to be able to read it.
Was the cold maybe
intentionally? Yes. Not intentionally. That's just
that
what the
question. I'll just repeat the question.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, the holes that you see in the garments are purely accidental, because this wood burning tool, I can't predict when that's going to happen. And it makes me happy when it does, because it shows the process. Let the process show.
Do you want to explain that a little?
Well, it's an unpredictable tool, especially the fabric. So I like to see the product of the process, because, let's face it, I'm talking about death. The burning, the holes, the destruction of the fabric sort of conceptually fits with what I'm doing. Have you all had a chance to go in? That piece, I didn't think it was going to happen. My family, my friends, in fact, one friend called it the death house because she said it's going to be the death of you, and I thought it was going to be. But the burning process just took, each of those pieces was so different. Each of them burnt differently. I thought, I'll never get through this. And then constructing it was impossible. The piece over here, the Josephine Baker piece, for those of you who haven't seen this, she was a dancer in the 20s, a singer, and her last words, and I can't really remember, you young people act like old men, you have no fun, something like that. From what I understand, she had a stroke directly after saying, she died that night after saying that, trying to seduce a young guy.
How do you collect all the fabrics? I mean, there's quite a bit that's gone into this one. Where did it all come from?
Goodwill, Salvation Army. Yeah. Working this way is a lot cheaper than paying.
So is that fabric from a lot of different sources?
Yes.
Is that tent fabric?
Yeah, that I just looked for black garments over and over and over again. I collected hundreds of garments. Yes?
What time span does this work represent?
So working on it since 2014. And I'm not done. It's incredible. I thought, usually I lose patience after a while. I just know when I'm finished with a series. And I'm not done with this one. working in a series is so important to me. And I, when I taught, I taught seriality, you know, this concept that you plug into a certain program in a way, and you stick to that program with the belief that at the end of it, you'll be happy, even though each piece along the way looks kind of sad or doesn't make you satisfied. You have to believe in the system enough that at the end of the system you'll be happy. And that's how this piece, how this whole series happened. At the beginning I thought, this is not going to work. But I stuck with the system that I had in mind, which is burning the text over and over and over again, embellishing where I thought I needed to. And don't separate it, don't think about each piece until the whole thing was done, and that's where I am.
So do you still have more people that whose last words you've collected and plan to work on?
Yes, I'm still working on it, and funny you should ask, right now I've started a series on the last words of death row inmates, and I think I have probably 15 or so done so far.
And how have you done the research for that?
Internet. You can find anything. Yeah, that's where all these last words came from.
What's the spirit of those last words? Does any one spirit find itself in common, or does it present such a contrast for you artistically? As you present it,
I'm not sure. What's?
Is there anything of those last words that has a commonality that when you go to do your artistic expression, pulls them together, or are they also diverse?
Well, I think they're diverse for sure. Yeah, there isn't a common thread. Some are hilarious. Some are tragic. I've cried, I've laughed. I mean, I get all kind of emotions from these. But there doesn't seem to be one thread that connects all the words. They go back to history, different nationalities, different causes of death. Death by accident, death by suicide. Yes.
So when you're reading through these, you just keep reading till you get an idea for one and just latch on to that?
Yes, I have hundreds available.
Yes?
Two unrelated questions. First, why does it matter to you? Why do these last words matter? Why have you been working on this for 3 years? Is it personal? And then also there's, I think, three pieces we haven't talked to, but I'm just curious if you could read those or say like, first,
sure.
Why does it matter?
Without sounding morbid, death is interested. We're all going to die. And I think, you know, we all have our different reasons for either avoiding it or thinking about it. In my case, I think when I started losing friends or loved ones, in a way, I wanted to know what they experienced in that moment of transition. And so when I lost the first person I knew close to me, that's kind of when this all began. The fear of death, I guess maybe I'm trying to face it, doggone it, you know? I'm not gonna be afraid of you. That could be part of it. It's just interesting to me. Many people think that death is what began religion. We had to find a way to face death and not be afraid. So that's all in there, and it's just been the story. The pieces that I haven't talked about, did that answer your question?
It did, yes.
This piece, allegedly, and it's hard to get the background, an actor in 2011, Christopher Grace, said I really need a therapist. And he said that on stage before committing suicide. He was in a production in Greece. Now, here's a case, Alice, where the fabric doesn't fit the human, because Christopher Grace is obviously a man. But I wanted to weave something so insanely that you would get the sense of that I really need a therapist, because I thought I really needed a therapist after creating this. This is another outlier. These are people whose obituaries were in the Columbus Dispatch. And I was interested in how the words never say death, never says this person died. These are all avoiding those terms. For instance, this person, his earthly journey ended peacefully. Heaven has reclaimed one of its angels here on earth. He beheld his Savior face to face. Things like that. I think that's interesting, you know, that whoever wrote these things could not bear to say this person died. And I don't know if you've paid any attention to the obituaries. Well, if you read obituaries, it's kind of a dark thing to do anyway. But I've noticed so many times it's bold when it actually says he died. Other piece that I haven't talked about. This is a woman named Olive Thomas. She said, pretty weak, but I'll be all right in a little while, don't worry, darling. And she said that in 1920. She said that to her husband. They were in a hotel room. He was taking a drug for syphilis, which is apparently a poison. She accidentally ingested it. She went to the hospital. She said this to him because he was distraught. She died.
Would you repeat what she said, please?
What it says?
Yeah.
Pretty weak, but I'll be all right in a little while. Don't worry, darling. Hmm. But she was an actress, and I thought kind of a flashier, more beautiful fabric. I have samples over here. I have the tool I use, if anybody's interested in looking at it. This is it. I mean, all the work is with this. And it gets real hot. I burnt myself a couple of times, and it's impressive, believe me. And then I have some samples here of fabrics, and you can see what happens when that touches fabric. Each one is so totally different. So there was a learning process, clearly, in what fabrics to use.
Did you find there was a difference between, like, natural fabric and polyester or something like that? Does one melt better than the other?
Yes. Yes. The hardest was 100% cotton, for some reason.
You know, didn't want to give it.
Right, yeah. No, but I do like polyester.
When you choose a fabric, you keep in mind that you're going to have to be burning it, or just go ahead and do whatever.
I just experiment. I mean, I've got bins and bins of fabric. If anybody needs fabric, I've got it.
So where's this thing going with these constructs?
Who says it will?
You have to pick it up and go.
Oh, this. Oh. I thought you meant Tammy Faye. No, I have a method for putting it up and taking it down, and it's not pretty, but it will come apart. It's actually a folding gazebo. It's got a lot of Velcro and things you don't want to know about in there. I'm holding that thing together, chewing gum.
Do you put this on some kind of a base when you're doing this?
Yes.
Fireproof or something?
Yeah. It's a stack of muslin on a piece of wood.
Amazing. It's just amazing to me that it doesn't scorch more of the fabric.
Well, Some fabrics do.
A little bit.
Yeah.
I see one here that does.
Right. Yeah, it's hard to predict. You would think after all this time that I could predict, but I still make a lot of mistakes. Yes?
For the big tank, first you broke everything, and then you use the fabric to... So you have written on all of those first.
Yes.
And then, you
and then I assembled it. And that's when I realized that... And it's all on the other side. It's from the, yes, from the inside. That's why I consider it an inside-out garment, because all of the text is on the inside. And then I assembled it and wasn't happy with the fact that you couldn't really read it, most of it. So I had to kind of reburn.
You had to reburn after it was assembled?
Well, no, I took it all apart and reburned, yeah.
I haven't been inside yet. Is there a light from inside to see, or you just see
from the holes?
What you can see.
Right. Yeah, I encourage you to do that and just sit there. In fact, that's the stool that goes in there. You can see the little stars on the stool. And just look.
Also, since I have the microphone, I'm curious to know, like the fabric and the garments of these pieces here, where they came from, how you found them, what was inspiration to each specific fabric or like that. That was a coat, I guess, or a shirt?
A man's shirt.
One?
Yes.
Just, I'm curious to understand more about these materials and how you chose them.
Well, I think, you know, Alice kind of asked that question. It just depends on the phrase. It depends on if I have a piece of fabric that it just thrills me, I will look for the words to go with that fabric. If in the case of Bobby Fischer, I just felt the need to have a black shirt. I don't know why, but it just seemed right that I would have a black shirt. So each one.
The third one with the stripes.
Yes. Well, it's got cufflinks. And buttons and kind of a, I think I started with a, I know I did, a tuxedo shirt. Because I was thinking George Sanders, and if, for those of you familiar with George Sanders from old movies, very sophisticated British actor, I thought, you know, it required cufflinks and a fancy man's shirt. So each one came from a different direction. This show, of all of the work, there is a lot of color normally. In all 50 pieces, all kind of color. But for this show, I decided to keep it pretty somber. First of all, because I knew that Paula uses a lot of color, saturated color. And rather than have competing shows, I thought it would be kind of interesting to have the black and white side and the deep color side. But normally there's a lot more color. I showed at Dublin last summer, and that show was very colorful. So, yeah, depends on the show.
And you mentioned Paula. Paula,
yes.
Mm-hmm. And you've worked together with her, or you know of her work. Tell us a little how it is that you have worked together and coordinated.
We've known each other since the late 90s, and we're the same age. We have kind of the same aesthetic as far as art. And we have shown together a few times. Most notably, we did an exhibit in Newark at the place called the Brooks Gallery out there, and did a huge installation. And we decided we'd try to get some sort of big installation going again. And that's when we wrote a proposal for the Cultural Arts Center. But yeah, we've known each other for a long time.
And she stayed with painting. She coordinated the painting while
she has stayed with painting. know, she stayed true to the paint. She loves paint.
Yeah, it's a beautiful show together.
Yeah, we were happy. Anything else?
I'm just curious why you chose that for Eleanor Roosevelt. What's the connection with all the paintings?
Well, she speaks of a certain era. Vintage gloves speak of that era. Women don't wear gloves anymore, but in her generation, they did. And the vintage hankies. But I also liked the little bit of the humor. Her words, let's face it, are kind of funny, you know, utter nonsense. And so I thought I'd kind of make a humorous, nonsensical piece from that. But that's why the gloves.
Well, let's go back a while in your life as you studied painting. What brought you to that? What did you appreciate growing up in terms of, when you look back, fabric, paint?
When, let's see, back in the 70s, before I had any training at all, I was doing pastel work, pastel portraits. In fact, I sold it, you know, malls. I'd be in the mall with a little display and High State Fair. You know. In fact, if anybody owns an old portrait of Woody Hayes, I probably did it. And I thank you for buying that because it probably fed me for a week. But yeah, that's what I did. And then I decided I wanted to go to school and really learn how to paint. I was afraid of paint. Pastel seemed easy to me. And so I went to High State University, transferred to Marshall University, got a BFA there and an MA in painting, began to teach, and decided, yeah, let's go all the way and go ahead and get the MFA in painting. And painting, figurative painting, and that's what I did. Based on what you know about me now, that I have this sort of interest in mortality, I was doing these figures, figurative work, portrait work, but how do I talk about what really interests me with the figure? And I started to do these shrouded figures. I would cover them up and then I would use text in these paintings. But at that time, the text was based on opera. Because to me, opera, drama, Italian opera, I thought it fit my whole message. And still though, it's all symbolic, I didn't want symbolism in it. I wanted direct translation of what I was interested in. So that's when I left painting and went to this.
When you incorporated the operatic lyrics, were they in the language that the operas were in?
Yes, they were in Italian. Yeah. But I was drawing it. You know, I was using some sort of tool and just making the text that way, in a predictable way, with marker that's when I decided, that's boring, that's predictable, what else can I use?
So were you artistic as a child? Did you do drawing and all that stuff?
I think I did.
What was that, Nika?
I asked if she was artistic as a child.
I did a lot of drawings of Sean Connery. Yeah, I remember drawing a lot of portraits. But I also remember drawing I remember trying to draw God a lot. It was in there early.
Did you grow up in Columbus?
Yes, Worthington. Anyone heard of Flint School? Worthington? It's gone. Yeah, that's where I went to grade school. Six grades in three rooms at a little tiny school. Yeah. And then I moved to Arizona, moved to Florida, moved to West Virginia, and always ended up back in Ohio.
And was that was teaching?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I taught at Marshall, I taught at WVU, and Shawnee State, and OSU. But I wasn't, I just happened to be in those places, so that's why I taught.
And you taught art?
Yes.
Yeah. Did you like teaching?
Yes. I love teaching. That's the problem for any teachers in here. You love teaching and you love making art, and the two sometimes are in conflict. There's no time. I love the students. I miss teaching sometimes, but then I think, well, I wouldn't be able to do this. So. Follow me into the tent?
Yeah,
that's like great idea. Follow you into the tent. Hi. It holds more than one person, so, you know.
You haven't seen it.